Thanks, Des. I'll ask Dr. Rupert Herbert-Brown from the Stimson Centre all the way from London to start us off for this afternoon's session. Thank you.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Firstly, I'd like to thank the Royal Australian Navy for inviting me here to speak to you today. And secondly, specifically to my Australian hosts, on behalf of England, apologies for not giving you guys a better match at Twickenham last weekend. Your lads are to be congratulated. A masterclass, although one can't help but noticing it's been on the TV over and over and over again. Right, enough of that. The South China Sea. Amidst a drastic fall in the oil prices and ongoing geopolitical tensions, several international oil companies have halted exploration plans in the South China Sea due to cost and security concerns. In the meantime, however, some states continue to maintain drilling operations and in contested waters in the northwestern sectors of the SCS. These facets and extant interstate relations have shined a spotlight on the security issues that impact upon oil and gas activity within the region. But geopolitical strains notwithstanding, relatively speaking, how important are the reserves, E&P projects, and transportation of petroleum in the region? And what are the security implications associated with the industry in the SCS? These are the questions that this paper seeks to address. Ultimately, the paper argues that it is the oil and gas transported through the SCS that is of far greater strategic relevance than what lies beneath it. In geological terms, the SCS is rather promising as a petroleum system due to the presence of multiple tertiary sedimentary basins, which are generally considered optimal formations for oil-bearing strata. These sedimentary buildups have given rise to the productive offshore and gas fields in the northwest coasts of Borneo and Sumatra and the northeast coast of the Malaysian Peninsula. Assessing in detail the full nature of petroleum geology in the basins of the SCS is currently not possible due to the lack of comprehensive seismic survey data outside of that acquired in territorial waters where oil and gas production has been taking place for some time. It is the very fact that the full petroleum deposit potential of the SCS remains unknown which gives rise to the compelling dichotomy of this issue. The promise of substantial hydrocarbon reserves provokes claimant states into variously strident claims on exclusive EEZs so they can explore for potential resources. However, paradoxically, it is also the very uncertainty of the true volume of oil and gas deposits that acts as a restraining force on the prospect of more serious conflict, as states are unlikely to risk precipitating wider conflict over resources that may not even exist in economically viable reserves. Inevitably, there are multiple conflicting estimates of the reserves lying in the geology under the SCS. Five notable estimates captured in this table offer perspective on the problem. The EIA assesses that the great majority of proved and probable reserves have already been determined to exist, overwhelmingly in uncontested parts of the South China Sea. According to the World Bank, the region has estimated proven reserves of a minimum of 7 billion barrels of oil and some 900 trillion cubic feet of gas. The petroleum consultancy Wood Mackenzie estimates an aggregate figure of only 2.5 billion barrels of BOE equivalent improved in oil and gas reserves. The USGS, however, theorizes that the SCS could contain between 5 and 22 billion barrels of undiscovered reserves and between 70 and 290 trillion cubic feet of gas. And finally, according to state-owned CNOOC, the basins within the South China Sea could very likely contain some 125 billion barrels of oil and 498 trillion cubic feet of gas. Overall, the data reveals a compelling contrast. There are either comparatively modest oil and gas deposits in the SCS, or there are petroleum reserves of global strategic relevance. For the time being, I tend to favor the estimates put forward by the EIA for two reasons. Firstly, the estimates are also based upon empirical survey data from the individual countries concerned, where there has been long-standing offshore exploration and production. And secondly, because the data are derived from multiple international sources, both government and industry. In this instance, CNOOC, National Oil Companies, IHS, Oil and Gas Journal, and PFC Energy. It is instructive to ask at this point to get a reality check on how the SCS compares to other regions in this regard. Put another way, what is its comparative strategic importance relative to other areas in terms of estimated reserves? The graph shown reveals the estimated reserves in the SCS juxtapose those of other regions in the world, which are considerably lower than all of the other areas for both oil and gas. As can be seen, South America and the Caribbean, Sub-Saharan Africa, the Middle East and North Africa, North America and the FSU have many times the proven and probable reserves of those in the SCS. Gas reserves in almost all of the other regions far exceed those of the South China Sea. In order to impart petroleum geopolitical context on the space, the table here shows the proved and probable reserves in uncontested areas as assessed by the EIA. Currently available information indicates that there are even fewer reserves inside contested areas, notably the Paracel Islands and the Spratly Islands, as shown in this map. The full extent of oil and gas exploration, development, and production in the South China Sea is too extensive to cover in my presentation. However, I do address it in detail in my paper. Suffice to say that Brunei, China, Indonesia, Malaysia, the Philippines, and Vietnam have long-standing and sizable ED&P industries and projects. Currently, in the context of territorial disputes in the SCS, it is the exploration for oil, specifically the seismic surveying projects and exploratory drilling in areas contested by China and Vietnam and between China and the Philippines that have been of greatest security concern. In the context of the number of regional industrial states that import huge volumes of petroleum on a daily basis, there are few more dynamic and strategically important areas than the SCS. Indeed, once the figures of volumes of crude oil, refined products, LNG is transported into, via, and within the SCS is assessed, it is clear that the volume of petroleum on the water, as we say, at any one time, is arguably of far greater strategic significance than the oil and gas reserves located within it. Indeed, it is my contention that it is this latter reality that acts as the critical moderator on tension levels between states in the region. According to data from Lloyd's List Intelligence's APEC system, approximately 14.7 million barrels of crude are lifted by tankers into and within the South China Sea and the Gulf of Thailand each day. This amounts to approximately 30% of all global oil conveyed by sea. And that's approximately 5.4 billion barrels a year, or equivalent to roughly 2,682 laden VLCCs every year. Some 94% of this volume enters the region via the Strait of Malacca and Singapore. This substantial volume of crude is driven in particular from demand from China, Japan, and South Korea, which still also have considerable large domestic refining capacity. A not insignificant volume of crude oil, almost a million barrels a day, is also exported by states inside the region. The table shown gives a comparative volumes transported by tankers sailing from regional states. Most of this oil is shipped to other states inside the SCS. However, some is lifted through the SCS on its way to terminals in Australia, Cambodia, New Zealand, Papua New Guinea, and Thailand. The bulk of interregional movements of crude are shipped in roughly even volumes to China, Japan, Singapore, and South Korea. Approximately 200,000 barrels a day are lifted through the Strait of Lombok to Australia and to island states in the southwestern Pacific. Though the future specifics of demand for individual volumes and destinations will of course change over time, the overall picture is one of increasing petroleum demand in the region. BP's Energy Outlook for 2035 puts forward the following projections. Asia Pacific's proportion of energy consumption increases to 47% over the next 20 years, and net imports increase by 88%. Though regional energy production expands by some 52%, consumption grows by 60%. Regional demand for natural gas and oil increases by 19% and 41% relatively out to 2035. The map shown provides a useful depiction of routings of oil, LNG, and products on the water in the SCS. This visualization is instructive when examining the geopolitical and security issues as they pertain to the region, as it illustrates oil flow orientation and volume corridors and indicates the obvious corollary of tanker concentrations and their proximity to potential security flashpoints. In 2014, 333 billion cubic metres of natural gas was traded globally by sea. In the same year, countries bordering the SCS imported some 223.8 billion cubic metres, or 373 million cubic feet of LNG, which, as you know, is obviously shrunk due to the cooling process, constituting a little over 67% of all the LNG lifted by sea in the world. Accepting volumes that transit from the Pacific, from the US, Trinidad and Tobago, Peru and Russia, this means that annually 63% of almost two-thirds of all the LNG on the water each year passes through the SCS, the Gulf of Thailand and the Sulu and Celeb seas. On a given day, thus, some 1 billion cubic metres of LNG is being shipped through the region, the equivalent of five laden Q-Flex tankers. The graph and table shown here illustrate the breakdown of importing countries in the region, which reveals the dominance of Japan, South Korea, and China. Demand for LNG in the major economies of ASEAN is predicted to grow by more than five times over the next 10 years, as production volumes in Malaysia, Indonesia, and Brunei slow amid increasing domestic demand. The seaborne trade in refined petroleum, that's things like LPG, gasoline, naphtha, jet, diesel, and heavy fuel oil, to, within, and from the SCS, is now a petroleum phenomenon of regional strategic significance. This is because the majority of states in the region no longer have the domestic refining capacity to service their own needs, and thus any protracted disruption resulting from a regional conflict or a security crisis could constitute a serious national security from an economic perspective. An exact measure of the quantity of refined petroleum on the water of this nature of any given time is problematic to determine with any precision. However, an estimate can be derived from the total volumes being imported. This equates to some 3.4 million barrels a day, or 16 to 40 product tankers on the water at any one time. On the supply side, the primary exporters remain Singapore, China, Japan, Malaysia, and Thailand in descending order of magnitude. However, as future demand steadily increases and as the smaller, less economically viable refineries close in Malaysia, Thailand, and Australia, the future trade pattern will become more skewed towards the mega refining nodes. This will also include large streams of refined product entering into the region from Saudi Arabia, India, and the United States. Let us now turn to some security issues. When viewed juxtaposed other piracy-prone areas in the world, Southeast Asian waters, by a wide margin, are now the most dangerous in the world. Indeed, as the graph illustrates, vessels in Southeast Asia are over four times as likely to be attacked as those in the next highest region, Africa. And the threat to shipping in Southeast Asia is over twice that of the rest of the world combined. Analysis of piracy reveals some interesting important trends with regards to threat scale, vessel typology, and concentration. Firstly, as shown in this graph, the threat of piracy in Southeast Asian waters has been steadily increasing since 2012. In the context of the threat to the petroleum sector, the overall situation is not good. The graph here reveals a rise in attacks against product tankers that stands out against the overall diminishing attacks worldwide. This has been due to the growing threat of hijacking of product tankers in West Africa and Southeast Asia. Viewed in totality, there has been a clear rise in attacks involving petroleum sector vessels since 2010. It is the deliberate targeting of product tankers by armed and experienced and determined pirates in Southeast Asian waters that is becoming of increasing concern. During 2014, of the 13 recap category 1 incidents, all involved attacks against product tankers. This matter is explored in detail in my paper. However, the map illustrates there is a clear navigational logic to the location and concentration of attacks against laden product tankers that have sailed from Singapore into the SCS. The sea areas marked in red indicate aggregations of Cat 3 piracy incidents in the last 3 years, which also coincide, unsurprisingly, with greater concentrations of vessel traffic. The piracy threat to tankers in Southeast Asian waters does not constitute currently a strategic level concern to the region or to the flow of petroleum from source to market. Nevertheless, the risk to vessels is at worrying levels. Whole cargoes are being stolen at sea by increasingly capable and very well-connected criminals, and some seafarers are losing their lives in the process. If unchecked, this threat will persist and could eventually result in the disruption of conveyance of refined products in the region. Terrorism. To date, there is no history of terrorist attacks directed against the maritime petroleum sector in Southeast Asia, and no evidence or reporting to suggest that such a maritime threat potentially currently exists. Nevertheless, despite prudent intelligence gathering, if there is one thing that holds true of terrorism, in particular maritime terrorism, is that a previously uncharted threat can emerge with alarming abruptness and in a location not previously assessed as vulnerable or likely. For this reason, an appreciation of what has gone before can be utilized as valuable extrapolation to assess the future risks to oil and gas infrastructure and shipping. The threat of terrorist attacks in the maritime domain has manifested itself in numerous ways, such as hijackings, WBIDs, amphibious-style assaults, and the use of IEDs. In the context of the maritime petroleum sector, three incidents are useful for their extrapolative value in determining the possible form and effectiveness of attacks in the future. The WBI attack against the Limburg in October 2002, the WBI attack against Al-Basra and Khor Alamaya terminals off Iraq in 2004, and the WBI attack against the M-Star in July 2010. There is greater detail in my paper, however, due to the constraints of time, I will confine my remarks on maritime terrorism to those made. However, I offer here a threat summary in this slide. Whilst it seems almost inconceivable that regional geopolitical tensions driven by competing territorial disputes could precipitate a widespread conflict involving two or several states, this issue has been and continues to be part of both academic and journalistic discourse. Indeed, multiple incidents between states and the SCS, some very serious, necessitate that the confluence of competing maritime claims, areas of existing potential oil and gas exploration and production, and sea lines of communication containing enormous volumes of petroleum in transit must be assessed for their capacity to both provoke and as a setting of more serious conflict at sea. Prior to offering my views on the issue, it is valuable to provide a composite visual perspective on the locations of the various features highlighted earlier and their locations and scale relative to one another as shown in this slide. The following list of incidents in contested parts of the SCS are directly related to the oil and gas sector. While some were very serious in their own right, they must be viewed amidst other developments such as diplomatic protests, exclusive claims to territory, thought to contain oil and gas reserves, and the reclamation of land and the building of airstrips and infrastructure on islands that sit aside major slots. In May 2011, a clash involving a Vietnamese seismic survey vessel and a Chinese maritime patrol vessel off the south central coast of Vietnam and south of Hainan Island. In June 2011, a Norwegian-flagged seismic survey ship under contract to PetroVietnam clashed with Chinese patrol vessels in disputed EEZ waters. In May 2014, Vietnamese and Chinese vessels collided in contested waters near the Paracel Islands when Sinuk begins exploratory drilling with a semi-submersible rig, HS981. Following a collision with a Chinese vessel, a Vietnamese fishing boat sinks close to the rig. And finally, in June 2015, most recently, Sinuk has redeployed the HS981 back into disputed waters to recommence drilling operations, which has provoked diplomatic protest. Could the geopolitical issue in the SCS evolve from being a collection of flashpoints into a major regional conflict that could seriously disrupt international supplies of petroleum and other maritime trade? It would be irresponsible to say that there is no possibility of a major conflict in and over the SCS. However, it is plausible to judge the risks of one. One logical approach to this is to examine the disputes between states in a cost-benefit context to measure the relative risk of armed conflict juxtaposed to the maintenance of the status quo. The dispute between many of the states of the Paracel at Spratly Islands in the SCS is existential. Indeed, variously, the disputes between states in the region have been ongoing since the 1970s. However, without wanting to diminish the seriousness of the limited conflicts and skirmishes over the years in terms of loss and life and material, these disputes have not provoked a major war. There is an excellent reason for this. States in the region do not seek a major conflict with their neighbors. Why? Because it's bad for business and bad for trade. In a globalized world with deeply interdependent economies and a central trade reciprocity, the need for unfettered navigation through major slots is essential to all. Furthermore, as shown in the early part of this presentation, there are neither sufficient proven and probable oil and gas reserves nor a dependable understanding of undiscovered reserves to warrant risking a major conflict just to control sea areas that might have no deposits of fundamental economic value. This highlights the clear separation between the very uncertain strategic value of risking major conflict over hypothetical reserves and the very real strategic importance of maintaining the free flow of crude oil and natural gas shipments through the SES for the benefit of all. My final slide here offers a summary of some of the key points made in my presentation. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Rupert. Now I'd like to invite Dr. Peter Chalk of the Iran Corporation, who's traveled from Phoenix, Arizona to take the lectern. Thanks, Peter.
Thank you very much. firstly, I'd also like to thank the Royal Australian Navy for the opportunity to be here. It's nice to be in Sydney, and I'm looking forward to enjoying an interactive session this afternoon. Firstly, I'd like to say that all the comments that I'm making today are my own. They do not reflect those of the RAND Corporation or the views of any of its sponsors. And with that caveat, I should have a job to go to when I leave this place at the end of the week. Firstly, I'd like to say a few words about the nature of contemporary security in the international system. Very few of the threats that we face today have the character of direct military aggression stemming from a clearly defined sovereign source. Threats have become more opaque, more diffuse, more complex in nature. They frequently bear off one another, which serves to increase their individual threat quotient. Most importantly, they cannot be readily deterred by the traditional defenses that states have erected to defend both themselves and their territories and citizens. The maritime realm remains particularly vulnerable to these types of threat contingencies. Roughly about 3/4 of the Earth's planet is covered by water, most of which takes the form of high seas that lie beyond the single sovereign jurisdiction of any single state. These over-the-horizon waters are bounded by territorial waters, inland tributaries, riverines, that either due to a lack of resources or due to a lack of political will, remain effectively unpoliced. Compounding the situation is the unregulated nature of maritime commerce, which is designed to be as open and accessible as possible, essentially to keep costs low and turnover high. While that may be good for business, it obviously also opens up numerous opportunities for criminals and terrorists to exploit the maritime trading system for their own nefarious purposes. And what I want to focus on today are two types of maritime threat that have gained increased prominence over the last several years on maritime crime and maritime terrorism. Firstly, I just want to have a quick word about definitions of armed maritime crime. When I'm talking about armed maritime crime, I'm adopting a definition that is wider than the one used for piracy under UNCLOS. I include attacks in territorial waters, and I also include attacks that are mounted against ships at anchor. As I have shown on this slide, we had about 1,824 actual or attempted incidents between 2010 and July 2015. Those figures come from the International Maritime Bureau. And that equates to about 28 incidents a month. The overall number of incidents has declined over the last 2 years, largely as a result of improved security off the Horn of Africa. And I'll get on to that in a minute. However, as Dr. Herbert Burns has said, armed maritime crime remains a particularly serious problem in Southeast Asia. We've had an increasing and very worrying trend in small product tanker hijackings. Average thefts here are around about $1 million apiece. And Indonesia, again, is now the most prone region in terms of armed maritime crime. When we are looking at armed maritime crime, it's possible to differentiate between three broad categories. At the very low end of the spectrum are attacks against ships at port. This is basically petty theft. It involves opportunistic muggers who creep on board vessels and go after cash and portable high-value items. Average theft maybe about $15,000. It's not particularly serious. More problematic is the ransacking of ships in territorial waters or on the high seas. Here the target is the cargo of the vessel in question. These types of attacks are carried out by well-organized gangs, generally pretty well-armed, and they're quite prepared to use force and furtherance of their objectives. In many cases, crews will either be detained in the captain's quarters, thrown overboard, or killed. That vessel then becomes a rogue vessel, a vessel that is essentially unmanned. And obviously, if one of these vessels is left to drift in a congested sea lane of communication, it has serious ramifications for the safety of maritime navigation. The nightmare scenario being a rogue vessel crashing into an oil tanker, leading to a major petroleum oil slick. At the high end of the spectrum are outright hijackings of vessels themselves. Here, the target is not the cargo, the target is the vessel. Traditionally, many of these types of attacks involve the seizure and reflagging of vessels for the purposes of fraudulent trade through the so-called phantom ship phenomenon. More recently, however, they have taken the more straightforward purpose of the seizure of ships in order to elicit ransom payments. And obviously, this is the type of armed maritime crime that we saw off the Horn of Africa, which reached its zenith between 2008 and 2012. World Bank estimate there was about $400 million in ransom payments paid out between 2010 and 2012, so it was a fairly serious problem. That problem has declined largely as a result of the deterrent effects from international naval patrols, ship owners' better adherence to best management practices, and the increased use of private security companies, although the use of private security companies has a number of negatives that are also associated with those. I'd be happy to address that in the Q&A session because I don't want to take up time during my presentation on that at the moment. This just gives a breakdown for 2014, and as I said, Indonesia is now the most prone region in terms of armed maritime crime. Hit the wrong one. So why should we care about our maritime crime? Well, it's a phenomenon that transcends human security, political security, and economic security. From the standpoint of human security, attacks constitute a direct threat to the lives and welfare of a variety of citizens from a variety of flag states. Figure here, 3,675 taken or hostage or kidnapped between 2010 and July 2015. Philippines has been most severely affected, largely because Filipinos constitute the largest mariner state in the world. And the situation has been so bad with the Philippines that all mariners are now required to undergo anti-piracy training before they actually go to sea. Our maritime crime has a direct economic cost in terms of mitigation measures, fraudulent trade, stolen cargo, and delayed trips. According to Oceans Beyond Piracy, which is a specialized project of the One Earth Foundation based out of Denver, which has done the most in-depth cost analysis of our maritime crime, the cost of piracy alone off the Horn of Africa was between $7 and $12 billion. A year. Our maritime crime can also undermine governing legitimacy by encouraging corruption in littoral states. Corruption can include everything from turning a blind eye to the activities of armed syndicates to actually facilitating in the rapid transfer of stolen cargo. Corruption has been endemic in many countries around the world, including China, Brazil, Peru, the Philippines, and Indonesia. And our maritime crime has the potential to have a major environmental impact. As I said, often when a vessel is boarded by pirates, the crew will be detained or killed or thrown overboard. If one of these vessels were to crash into an oil tanker and you had a petroleum oil slick, that would not only cause irreparable damage to offshore resources and marine life, if left to drift, that oil slick could seriously erode elongated stretches of fertile coastal lowland. And that obviously has direct ramifications for any littoral state that depends on the oceans as a source of protein, either for domestic consumption or for regional export. And if a littoral state suddenly cannot provide the basic wherewithal in terms of food for its population, that also has the implications of opening up the possibility for mass protests. And the 2008 rice crisis that we saw in Asia, although not connected to our maritime crime, certainly does highlight the potential for unrest when a state can suddenly not provide the basic necessities for its population. So what are the contributing factors to our maritime crime? Well, traditionally, it was fed by two factors. One was the enormous amount of freight that moves by sea. Roughly 80% of commercial traffic moves by maritime conveyance. So that opened up an enormous array of potential targets. Much of this freight also was moving through congested sea lanes of communication, choke points, which ship owners chose in order to reduce the length of their journeys. The volume of shipping passing through straits such as the Strait of Hormuz, the Suez Canal, the Panama Canal, the Malacca Straits, obviously forces vessels to drastically reduce speed in order to ensure safe passage. And that makes them inherently susceptible to interception by fast attack craft that are launched from land. Our maritime crime in the contemporary era reflects the continued salience of those two factors in addition to a number of others. First is poverty and absence of legitimate economic activity. And obviously these were two major factors that fed into the increased proliferation and incidence of our maritime crime from Somalia. The average Somali earns less than $2 a day, but can make up to $150,000 from a successful hijacking. So obviously there was a major economic imperative to engage in the practice. There's also, our maritime crime is surprisingly risk, the risk associated with it is low. It's unlikely that you're going to be caught in the actual perpetration of an attack, and even if you do, the chances of prosecution are low, largely reflecting the fact that many states do not have statutes on their domestic books that actually criminalize piracy. That was one of the reasons why the European Union, the United Kingdom, and the United States entered into transfer agreements with countries such as Kenya, Mauritius, Tanzania, and the Seychelles, whereby those countries acted as third parties who would try and prosecute suspected pirates. I've already spoken about corruption. That provides the oil that allows our maritime crime to exist in the same manner that it allows other manifestations of organized crime to exist. We've also had insufficient coastal surveillance by many littoral states, largely because of the difficulty of mounting sustained patrols over very large archipelagos. Indonesia is a classic case here. It has been estimated that it would require at least 300 vessels to be operational at any one time in order to provide sufficient coverage over the Indonesian archipelago to drastically reduce the incidence of armed maritime crime. Indonesia does not have those resources at its availability, and arguably no state would be able to provide that sort of coverage at sea over a given and sustained period of time. Ready willingness to pay increasingly large ransoms. Ship owners have an unwritten rule that they're going to pay ransoms as quickly as possible. They want to get their vessels back while they're still seaworthy. The longer a vessel remains in captivity, the less seaworthy it becomes. They also want their vessel back so they can get their cargo back, their crew back, and they can get that vessel making money as quickly as possible. The average ransom payment in 2005 was about $150,000, but by 2010, the average had risen to around about $3 to $4 million, a substantial rise. And again, that provided the economic incentive on the part of pirate syndicates operating out of Somalia to continue to engage in the practice. And we have the global proliferation of arms. Many of the pirate syndicates and the armed maritime crime gangs that we see today are very well armed. They are not the Johnny Depps of this world with cutlasses. They are equipped with modern combat weapons, standoff ordnance, RPGs, and they are quite willing to use those, that force and those weapons to perpetrate their crimes. It is essentially the global proliferation of arms has allowed our maritime crime gangs to operate on a far more sophisticated and lethal basis than was previously the case. And that particular point highlights one of the ones that I made right at the beginning, whereby many of the non-state threats that we are facing today bear off one another. In this case, you have our maritime crime bearing off the illegal trade in light arms trafficking. To move on to terrorism, that is a picture of the MV Lindbergh that was attacked by Al-Qaeda in 2002. The historical track record of maritime terrorism is low. According to the Global Terrorism Database, only 0.2% of all incidents that have occurred over the last 40 years have occurred at sea or have been directed against vessels or offshore infrastructure. Why is that? Why have we not seen more incidents of terrorism at sea? Well, in order to operate for sustained periods at sea, you need certain specialist skills and resources. And many terrorist groups have simply lacked the money to provide those resources for sustained operations. At the same time, a number of groups have not existed close to the oceans or to the seas, and they have had no real perceived need to engage in maritime operations. Further factor of the nature of land targets. They are fixed, they are easier to hit, and most importantly, they are far more media accessible. If you bomb a shopping mall, CNN is going to be there within an hour, if not sooner. If you bomb a vessel on the high seas, chances are that you're not going to get that media statement on news for a number of days. The MV Lindbergh took about 5 days before that was confirmed as a terrorist attack. And for terrorists, instant media is absolutely essential to what they do. Without it, terrorism loses its potential force multiplier effect. Terrorists have also been traditionally tactically conservative. They are control freaks. They like to, precisely because they lack sufficient resources, they will always go after tried and tested methods that offer a reasonably high chance of success. The unpredictabilities that are associated with operating at sea, in that fact, has acted as a deterrent or a detractor from the perceived utility of conducting marine operations. Having said that, The notion of maritime terrorism today remains a concern for a number of reasons. First, we have seen a small but discernible spike in fairly high-profile operations. We had the bombing of the Cole in 2000, the bombing of the Lindbergh in 2002, the firebombing of Super Ferry 14 in the Philippines in 2004. We had the attack against the M-Star in the Strait of Hormuz in 2010, and we had the RPG attack against the COSCO Asia as it was transiting the Suez Canal in 2013. So there does seem to be something going on where groups have steadily sought to expand their operational ambit to include marine operations. Most of those plots have been associated with Al-Qaeda and its global affiliates. Al-Qaeda itself has, on numerous occasions stated its willingness to attack Western shipping interests as part of a wider bleed-to-bankruptcy strategy that is designed to bring the United States and its allies to its knees. The assumption is that the United States or the Western trading system's Achilles heel is energy. And if you start hitting oil tankers that are transiting key sea lanes of communication, you'll be able to deliver a crippling blow to the U.S. economy and to commercial trade in general. Another factor that has increased concern is state failure. Two major areas that we are concentrating on now are Libya and Yemen. Libya lacks a unified government. It has one, the internationally recognized government out of Tobruk, but it has another one under Libya Dawn that is based out of Tripoli. Of concern here is the fact that ISIS has gained established footholds in Libya, which could pose a potential threat to Western shipping interests in the Mediterranean. In Yemen, the escalating civil war has provided increased latitude for al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula to expand its geographic operational control in that country, notably along the south coast. AQAP now has direct access to the Gulf of Aden, which could facilitate attacks carried out in coordination with al-Shabaab from Somalia against Western shipping interests transiting the Gulf of Aden en route to the Red Sea and the Suez Canal. Another problem is the proliferation of floating armories, which is a byproduct of the increased use of private security companies. These floating armories contain everything that is necessary to support a small coup. Combat rifles, hundreds of thousands of rounds of ammunition, helmets, body armor, satellite communication systems. Unfortunately, these floating armories exist to endemic areas of political and terrorist instability, and many lack concerted security. So the possibility of one of these armories being hit by a militant group who then uses that material to further their own cause has grown as a cause of concern. And there is growing awareness that some of the same factors that are relevant to the growth of armed maritime crime also have relevance to terrorism, notably lax port security, insufficient coastal surveillance, the increased dependency of vessels to pass through congested sea lanes of communication where they become vulnerable to attack from fast attack craft launched from land. These are just some of the selected maritime incidents. They will be in the presentation. I won't go through those right now. If in fact groups are looking to expand their operational mandate to the maritime realm, why would they want to do that? Well, I've come up with three possible rationales. The first is to cause mass casualties. And here, the most relevant vessels that we are talking about are passenger ships, both cruise ships and ferries. Both contain large numbers of people that are confined in a single space. They sail according to preset timetables. They remain susceptible to pre-departure attack, far more so than aviation, and they remain vulnerable to post-departure interception. Now, very unlikely that a terrorist group would be able to sink a cruise ship, largely because cruise ships are built with security as their foremost priority. However, there are a number of things that could be done on board a cruise ship whereby you get large fatalities. You could poison a salad bar, or you could have random shooting attacks that are directed against areas where large numbers of people congregate, such as in restaurants or in the casino, or disembarkation points when a cruise ship calls at a port of entry. Passenger ferries, however, are far more susceptible to cataclysmic attack. They have design features that make them very sensitive to subtle shifts in their center of gravity. Passenger ferries that transport vehicles, for instance, lack stabilizing bulkheads on their lower decks. Ferries themselves also preclude the option for 100% security because their basic rationale is to move people and vehicles as quickly as possible. You just cannot have 100% security for everything that is going on board a passenger ferry. To give you an idea of how easy it is to attack one, the bombing of Super Ferry 14 in the Philippines, that took 2 months of pre-attack surveillance. It was carried out by a single operative. It cost less than $400. The device was a very crude IED consisting of 16 sticks of dynamite in a hollowed-out television, and the attack led to 116 deaths. It had a very high payoff for a remarkably small investment. Another rationale could be to inflict major economic damage, and this is seen to have relevance to Al-Qaeda as part of its Bleed's bankruptcy strategy. Here, one of the most commonly postulated scenarios is to close a critical sea lane of communication in order to disrupt the mechanics of international trade, which has very little redundancy built into it. If you were to block the Suez Canal, that would require about 3 weeks extra steaming time. And that would have direct ramifications for goods that are either perishable or for energy products. And countries such as the UK, which only has reserve stocks of up to about 5 days of both energy and food, if the Suez Canal were to be shut, it would have significant ramifications for political stability due to the shortages that would result. And finally, I've alluded to this, attacks could be carried out to precipitate an environmental crisis, which then leads to a political crisis. And as I said, if any state is unable to provide the wherewithal in terms of basic necessities for their population, you do set the scene for a potentially serious political crisis within that country. So what is all this? This is my final slide. What are the implications for Seapower? Well, traditionally, Seapower was aimed at protecting sovereign trade routes from interference by another government's marine forces. Many of the threats that we are seeing today do not have that character. The functions of Seapower are not relevant to many of the sub-state threats that we face today that emanate from non-state actors. At the same time, the increasingly globalized nature of the commercial maritime traffic has made supply chain networks increasingly dependent on inventory, on systems that have very little, if any, redundancy built into them. The so-called just enough and just in time inventory basis remains inherently susceptible to exogenous shocks that are caused by either accidental or deliberate disruption. Established navies could play a meaningful role in helping to mitigate some of these threats. They have proven their worth in helping to combat the drug trade by facilitating interception in the Caribbean and the Pacific. They are increasingly playing an important role in addressing the migrant crisis in the central and eastern Mediterranean. And as I said at the beginning, international naval patrols were a very important factor in terms of providing a deterrent effect for piracy in the Gulf of Aden. If maritime navies are to play a more concerted role, one of the most logical ways they could do this is to provide assets that serve to augment the mitigation strategies of civilian agencies. Boats could be provided to facilitate coastal patrols, to provide for more concerted port security. Sailors could be embedded in Coast Guard and Marine teams to facilitate boarding duties and to facilitate the processing of suspected criminals or terrorists. And drones could also be utilized to enhance over-the-horizon surveillance to facilitate with the rapid identification of suspected rogue vessels. I would close by saying that I think that Seapower will continue to focus on conventional threats that take place on the high seas. However, these forces do have the potential to play a role in offsetting prominent non-state threats of the sort that we are seeing today. And given the potential ramifications that could result from a further escalation of either armed maritime crime or, more seriously, armed maritime terrorism, I think a strong case could be made for established navies to adjust their operational mandates and procedures in order to play a more concerted role in addressing those types of threats. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Peter. Well, Dr. Herbert Brown, Rupert, and also to Dr. Chalk, Peter, you've provided two very contemporary papers focused on energy security at sea and, of course, transnational maritime threats, which, of course, reflect the dark, violent and ungoverned side of globalisation and how we must reflect on the implications for sea power. I'll now open the floor to any questions which I know you all have. Can I ask... for those who do have questions, just to state your name, your organisation, and try and keep your questions sharp and focused. One question here. Just wait for the speaker there, mate. Good.
Sub Lieutenant Noddle Smith with the Royal Australian Navy. My question is for Dr. Chalk. Dr. Herbert Burns described the South China Sea as both a source of energy and a thoroughfare for it. He described the former as relatively low importance and already being impacted by conflict between regional nations. With respect to the latter as a thoroughfare, do you see the interstate conflict taking a toll, or given the international interdependent flow of energy, would you anticipate cooperation amongst the region's nations in combating maritime conflict, even while pursuing competing territorial claims?
I will certainly pass the table to Rupert on this, but I'll make some general remarks. I think that no state amongst the competing claimants within the South China Seas has any interest in seeing the disruption of throughput of trade in that region. It would make no sense in terms of their commercial assets. I think that there is potential for cooperation to deal with sub-state threats that may seek to disrupt energy flows going through that region, because it is of such importance both to the states themselves and also to the wider international community. Obviously, however, though, the problem it becomes problematic, essentially, because you're having to put a form of international cooperation over an area where there are competing demands and where there isn't a strong incentive to deal with threats on a multilateral basis. If anything, we're looking at sort of bilateral cooperation and coordination. And that's probably where you will see it. I will caveat that by saying, though, if there was a major attack and it was linked back to a non-state threat or to a non-state actor, then I think you would see the claimants themselves have a far greater vested interest in working together to ensure the viability of what is actually the maritime commons in that region. But I don't know if Rupert wants to add.
Certainly. I would echo what Peter has just said. To get a joint operation for sort of like coalition activity, if you like, to monitor sea lines of communication or contested sensitive waters, that kind of thing, first of all, as Peter alluded to, you need a diplomatic agreement before any of that even starts. You can't have warships and patrol vessels of sovereign states just sort of showing up for obvious reasons. And that, of course, flies in the face of the challenge of what we've got before us, is the very fact that these states are contesting these areas. I'd also add to that is the problem of logistics. It's not all states in the region that are going to have the resources to mount sustained coalition activity in that part of the world. And it's also even let's suppose for the sake of argument that bilateralism was to work in that area and you were to inject vessels which could sort of sustain themselves for elongated periods of time, as the Americans have been finding with sort of whether to challenge overflight in so-called sovereign airspace, how close do you go? How do you incur? Do you stay outside it? Does that do you any good in that line? So you then go back to patrolling in sort of international waters and so on, but where do those end and begin in this particular context? So you can see this is a deeply challenging thing which has to be handled very delicately. I would just end by saying that perhaps it's going to take some considerable or quite obvious threat to provoke states in a region of wherever it might be to come together, as it did off the Horn of Africa, to try and create a sort of a compound solution to that. Something quite obvious, perhaps like a terrorist attack of that nature, or some very serious clash which can't be ignored any longer, if you see what I mean. Does that help?
Good question. Next question, please.
David Barrister, Australian National University. This is a question for Rupert. I know this is a quite speculative, but in your judgment, how would you compare the oil and gas reserves in South China Sea with those in Bay of Bengal? How would you see the two regions in relative terms?
At the moment, it's all this problem of known and unknown at the moment. In the Bay of Bengal, we've got the opportunity to find out more about what's there. In fact, there's plenty of seismic survey activity which has been conducted and will be conducted in the coming year or so in the Bengal to establish what's in the littoral and off the continental shelves. Because the sort of competing maritime claims aren't quite as complex in the Bay of Bengal, slightly easier for the IOCs and the NOCs to go and actually try and establish what's there. In the South China Sea, as I mentioned in my sort of presentation, I've sided for the time being on the side of the sort of the more conventional estimates of the reserves. But the challenge that we have there is that there's bound to be more than there is than the reserves that are stated are suggested. That's inevitable. But we are not going to be able to find out in the short term what the extent of that is. I mean, for example, which I didn't kind of go into in detail in the presentation, the amount of reserves in the fringes of sedimentary basins in the central and north central parts of the South China Seas are likely to contain decent quantities of petroleum. I would suggest probably more likely gas than liquids. But we've got to go and find it. But even if we do, drilling in 2,000 meters water in those parts of the world, apart from some of it being incontested EEZs, is highly challenging. You're drilling at that depth, and the depth of the strata makes these things very complicated and very expensive. Whilst we've got oil at $48-$50 a barrel, very few companies are going to engage in that, except for perhaps, how shall I call it, diplomatic reasons. It's a problem now, because we don't know what we don't know. But to finish off with the Bay of Bengal, we've got an opportunity to find out a lot more about what's there.
Thank you.
Thanks, sir. Commander Josh Wilson, I work in Navy Strategic Command. I'd like to start off by thanking Dr. Chalk for giving me another reason to avoid salad bars. Thank you very much. Dr. Chalk, you talked about some of the causal factors for maritime crime and piracy, and drew some links around Somalia and the events around the Horn of Africa. Noting Dr. Herbert Burns' comments about the increased piracy in the South China Sea that we're currently seeing, would either of you care to postulate on what some of the causal factors on that might be?
I can start, yeah. The same causal factors that led to the resurgence of piracy back in 2004. The difficulty of coastal surveillance. The economic incentive for engaging in the practice. Lax port security and corruption. Now, the reason why piracy in Southeast Asia declined so dramatically in 2004 was ironically linked to a decision by Lloyd's of London to designate the Malacca Straits as an area of enhanced risk. Mm. And that caused Malaysia, Singapore, and Indonesia to initiate joint patrols in the Malacca Straits that significantly reduced the level of activity. The point I want to make is that the mitigation measures were always at sea. They never addressed the land-based factors that caused piracy to exist in the first place. And so they remained in place. And as the number of attacks declined, so the perceived need for the continuation of those very sustained trilateral patrols also declined. The pressure was lifted, pirates could operate again. And I would say that exactly the same dynamic is going to occur off the Horn of Africa. We have not addressed that problem at all. If the international naval flotilla, the mandate ends, and you see naval forces leaving that region, you see private security companies leaving that region, you're going to get a resumption of attacks, because the fundamental factors driving piracy in that area are all from Somalia, and no one is getting involved in nation building in Somalia.
Rupert, would you like to?
Sure. Good question, certainly, because it's a big issue, and one that I think needs more address, particularly with regards to Southeast Asia. You mentioned sort of like a causality. Coastal communities in some of these archipelagos, you know, particularly kind of in Indonesia, from a sort of an economic point of view or a wealth point of view, you know, still a lot of these communities are getting left behind. So there's still a big economic incentive for sort of seafarers or dwellers in these parts of the world to go after, as Peter was talking about in his address, to go after the rich pickings in those waters. And they've got a good legacy. They're good at it, too. And they know what can be achieved. Furthermore, the organization which has gone into this is a step change from what we saw towards the end of the 90s and in the early 2000s with regards to Southeast Asia. You know, these guys are getting it together. They're organized. They're getting, whilst the communities themselves don't have the money, but the organizations behind them, you know, are fixing these guys up with good intelligence about where vessels are, where cargoes are, the values of them, how to find them. And I'd also say that, you know, perhaps in this instance, seafarers are getting lax again. You know, we've got situations in that part of the world where, you know, vessels are being taken with comparative ease. You know, these vessels aren't afforded the same kind of security that we put together on both a military and on a private basis in the Horn of Africa and in the northern central Indian Ocean. And also, as these attacks get more successful, and you find that, as Peter was saying, talking about phantom vessels and whole cargoes being taken, particularly, of course, refined products, of course, which are easy to sell because they're already prepared. As pirates get better at it and they demonstrate to other groups and competing groups that this can be done, then, of course, you get this multiplier effect. So it comes back to the fact that we need to step in and start paying attention to this because, you know, guys are losing their lives. And, of course, that's what started to provoke, to say nothing, of course, of the cost of to the insurance community, why we started to get a grip of the problem in the Indian Ocean.
Here's Josh. I might ask our previous Chief of Defence Force, Admiral Chris Barry.
Yeah, Chris Barry, Admiral, former Chief of the Defence Force, now at Australian National University. As a follow-on to the previous question, 2 years ago I attended a presentation by the UNDPO organisation, which explained that pirates from the east coast of Africa, having been apprehended, will be sent ashore, sentenced to 21 years in prison, put in those prisons and be delighted to be there, because even though they're going to lose their life inside the prison, the conditions in those prisons are better than what they left. And so the problem we confront here is that big money finances the piracy operation, provides the tools for piracy, and the rewards for success. And yet, when they're caught, that is red-handed apprehensions, they're going to end up with 21 years in one of three prisons on the east coast of Africa, and then they're going to die there, and yet they still want to be there. It's not a bad outcome for a pirate. The Russians, on the other hand, as you can see if you look on YouTube, have quite a different solution. They had a ship apprehended by pirates, which they subsequently shackled the pirates to the guardrails at the back of the vessel and exploded it, sank into the sea, and guess what? They haven't had a problem since. Would you like to comment on that as a solution for this scourge, which has been going on for centuries?
As you feel free, Peter Rupert, sir.
String them up by the yard arm, eh? Well, there is a deterrent effect. The Russians have shown that their willingness to use force has had a, if you want to put a positive effect, in not only off the Horn of Africa, but also in the East China Sea. Whether or not those sorts of solutions can be countenanced today in the contemporary international system is debatable. Having said that, at least in theory and under strict international law, the UN Security Council did pass a resolution authorizing the use of all means, including military means, to address piracy off the Horn of Africa. No state actually acted upon that resolution. And the reason no state really had to, because the problem was deflected to private security companies who provided that one-on-one security that international naval flotillas cannot. Whether or not the answer in terms of deterrence lies with private security companies in the future is an open question. They certainly do have a deterrent effect. There has not been an instance where a ship with armed guards on board has been successfully hijacked. But there are a number of logistical, legal problems associated with many of these groups. Many are not audited. The IMO has come out with a basic standard for auditing these groups. But I think I'm right in saying as of the end of 2014, only 48 companies had been audited to that level. And when you think about how many are operating, that's not very many. There's legal problems in terms of having armed guards on board ships call into territorial waters. And then, of course, you've also got the implication or the potential of setting off an arms race with pirates themselves, who may think, well, if I'm boarding a vessel where there could be armed guards on board, I'm going aboard shooting. But the point is, though, there is no real deterrent effect for many of these individuals. They are coming from abject poverty where there is no prospect of a better life. And one thing I would like to say to follow on from a previous comment that Rupert said, you've got to take a look at coastal communities. In Somalia, many of the coastal communities had no incentive to cooperate with authorities because the pirates were providing what the state couldn't. They were providing jobs, they were providing water, they were providing food. And in that sense, they were seen as Robin Hoods. And until you can get viable cottage industries or micro fishery industries setting up and working, you're not going to make headway in that area. And there will be no incentive for these groups to stop doing what they do. But whether or not we should do what the Brits did and just bomb the hell out of these people, I'll let Rupert answer that one.
Sure, the Brits or the Russians? I would simply add to that that the creating or finding the right way out of the sort of the imbalance between the fact that these guys are prepared to take considerable risks to get off the beach, metaphorically speaking, juxtapose the sort of the deterrence that's out there. I was, you know, as a naval officer, I was always kind of disappointed in some respect that we didn't do more out there than perhaps we could have done, and that it was left to the private sector to do it. But then perhaps arguably from a logical perspective, that was the only way that it was going to work. I would sooner see the continuance of PMSCs out there in a deterrent capability, rather than creating or lessening the sort of the rules of engagement, as it were, to start taking really quite sort of draconian measures. So this balancing act is a problem. Also, of course, because that particular problem has now dissipated a lot, we're kind of losing our compass on it. I mean, Peter's brought it up again. It's the first time in a conference for a while that I've seen it raised again as an issue, because it's still there as a latent problem, and it hasn't been solved.
So if we take our foot off the gas a bit, then you know these sorts of things re-emerge, and I believe we're seeing that in Southeast Asia now.
Mike.
Admiral Barry, first of all, I feel for what you're saying. They're damned if they do and they're damned if they don't. I'd just like to just take a point with what Peter said with regards to the British bombing them. I, along with a lot of the colleagues, with some of my colleagues here, have been heavily involved in coalition maritime force operations out of Bahrain and dealing with piracy. I'm proud to say that in those instances where we were developing policies out of Bahrain and in dealing with those motherships that were providing support to the pirates at that time in 2010, which was really at the height of the pirates' activities around the IRTC in the Gulf of Aden, we took stringent methods, and the rules of engagements were very tight with regards to our engagement of those motherships that were off the main ports, particularly off Somalia, in those areas such as Hedari, in those areas off the east coast of Somalia. So I just want to make that point very clear. One of the areas that we haven't addressed is West Africa. Would you like to give us an idea or a sense with regards to maritime security in that area? We haven't seen much much of a similar assessment with regards to the rise of maritime crime, for example, off Nigeria in that area. Thanks very much.
My reference to the Brits were when they were dealing with the Barbary pirates in the 19th century. It wasn't a reference to what was going on now. The Gulf of Guinea, West Africa, is a black hole. We have very little knowledge of what's going on there, largely because there's a lack of reporting. There have been moves to integrate joint patrols, but they're nascent. It's a problem. There's a lot of attacks that have been directed against offshore platforms. A number of attacks are being orchestrated by pretty well-organized militants operating from the Niger Delta. The violence that is associated with armed maritime crime of West Africa is actually the most serious internationally. Although Southeast Asia is the most prone region for armed maritime crime, the most violent area remains West Africa. And then you've also got the issue here of just chronic corruption. Guinea-Bissau, Ghana, Nigeria, especially Nigeria. Corruption problem here is so endemic that it is providing the latitude for these gangs to operate. I actually spoke with a senior Nigerian naval officer a couple of years back, and the Nigerian Navy were making headway in terms of dealing with some of the attacks in Nigerian territorial waters, but mysteriously funding for a lot of what they were doing was suddenly cut off by the central government. And the assumption behind this was that certain members of the government were suddenly losing a kickback in some of the profits that were being taken from oil bunkering and from the illegal sale of petroleum to third parties in Lagos. So when you've got issues like that, it's incredibly difficult to institute effective national, regional, or international operations to counter the problem. I would say today, the most serious part of the world in terms of armed maritime crime is actually not Southeast Asia, it's probably the Gulf of Guinea, simply because of the violence thresholds and the chronic corruption that is characteristic of that region. And as we've seen, it's not only with respect to our maritime crime, I mean the drug trade. One of the reasons why Colombian cartels are going increasingly through West Africa is because they have bought off the highest levels of governance in countries such as Guinea-Bissau. And that it provides a much more secure indirect route to get cocaine to Europe. So it's a big problem. I don't know to what extent the regional community there is able to address it on its own. As I said, there have been moves to integrate information sharing centers in the Gulf of Guinea, but they're pretty nascent at this point.
Rupert, do you have any comments on that?
A couple of additions. Agree with totally what Peter was just said, except to add that on a wider scale, the response remains uncoordinated still in West Africa in terms of getting regional states in that northern bend of the Gulf of Guinea to react together. That's obviously compounded by the fact that their resource availability is very, very limited, to say nothing of a lack of sort of area surveillance and that kind of technology. From a seafarer's point of view, one of the differences, of course, on this East Africa thing West Africa thing juxtaposed the Somali problem was these guys are incredibly quick to violence. They're in there to steal either an entire cargo or the belongings inside the superstructure. And seafarers, on average, just not prepared to deal with that on their own. You know, if you're going to hunker down, you're still likely to lose the vessel. So that's one of the problems. Also, from a private maritime security perspective, it's still not possible to have armed ship security teams in that part of the world, which, as we've seen in other parts of the world, are still effective in as a form of deterrence. And the final thing that I'd add, of course, is it's a fabulous target-rich environment. You've got large numbers of product tankers there, laden, which are the locations in roads or alongside or at terminals, is often well known, and this information is freely traded by less reliable customers. And of course, the skill sets of these people have now become well developed in conducting ship-to-ship transfers, STS, in roads and so on at night, almost in a pre-packaged way. These things are facilitated and allowed as well. So it very challenging, and the problem is not going away.
I think I might just take the last question. Peter, you mentioned about black holes, and I think that's the crux of the problem, the size of the maritime domain, the magnitude of the ungoverned areas. What are some of the solutions? Because in my view, non-state actors, when they're being watched, such as by UAVs, they behave differently. So what can we do to actually, I guess, reduce the size of these ungoverned areas, I guess, for both Peter and for Rupert?
I think, it obviously comes down to cooperation. And coordination, interagency collaboration. And here I think it's probably unrealistic to think in terms of international cooperation. You've got to get coalitions of the willing, so sub-regional maritime agreements in places like the Gulf of Guinea or Horn of Africa or the Gulf of Thailand, where you get a small number of states that are coming together. They develop protocols, they initiate joint patrols, they have hotlines, they have rapid sharing of information and intelligence. They work together to amplify what are otherwise very minimal national resources. You've also got to work closely with coastal communities because they are the eyes and ears of what coast guards and navies do. If you don't get the private sector, if you don't get the public sector involved, you're missing three quarters of the picture. And I think we're only really coming to grips with that now. My last point here is that no matter what you do at sea, it's never going to be enough. Because all of these threats, they just don't manifest miraculously from the sea. They all have land-based drivers. And we're not doing enough to address the underlying causes. If we can get a grip on that, it will make the mitigation measures at sea much easier to contemplate and execute.
Thanks, Peter. Rupert?
Just briefly, in reference to your comment about UAVs, no doubt about it, a wonderful force multiplier, but even in trained hands, problematic to sort of utilize the full benefit, particularly low light, high sea states at night and that kind of thing. But let's say for the sake of argument, you've got it and it can be interpreted accurately. You've got to have the resources to respond to it. So if you see something happening, you've got to be able to put a platform in the area on task quickly to make it work with trained personnel and so on. And as far as West Africa goes, you know, we just simply don't have it. A big challenge on that front.
Thanks, Peter. Thanks, Rupert.
Ladies and gentlemen, that concludes Session 5, Transnational Threats. Would you please thank Dr. Rupert Herbert Burns and Dr. Peter Chalk. The next session commences at 3:40. If you could be in your places by 3:35, Session 6, the last session of the day, cooperation and networking.
Can I just have your attention, please? I just have one announcement to make. I'm the conference director. I can do whatever I want. A lot of what Rupert has said today has been contained in a report that has been commissioned by the Royal Australian Navy and by the Seapower Centre on oil on energy and fuel security. That report will be published shortly. We will signal it out to the Royal Australian Navy and we will publish it on our website at Seapower Centre, and we will also tweet it when that is ready to be published. Thank you again.
A lot of the issues that the fleet have been seeing are extended lead times and